What do you get when you combine a press board commonly used to make clipboards with surplus lipstick cases, some poplar plywood, vinyl tape, various bolts and screws, and a splash of paint? Just some of the most iconic guitars in history.
Again, boys and girls, and welcome to yet another edition of Live from the Tape Farm. As you may have surmised from the little intro and the title of this video, we are going to talk about the magic of Danelectro guitars. It really is something when you think about it. The materials that go into making these guitars are ridiculous. You know, it's when I started playing these guitars that I realized that, you know, all of that talk, now this is, I'm talking about electric instruments, not necessarily acoustic instruments, but from an electric instrument standpoint, all of the time and worry that goes into everyone talking about the building materials of their guitars and how their wood is from this exotic place, and it doesn't amount to a hill of beans. It really doesn't matter. It looks nice, don't get me wrong. I mean, a nice flame maple top on a guitar is gorgeous. But if I can make a guitar out of masonite, and it sounds great and plays great, then really all of that other stuff doesn't really matter all that much. As far as what you can do with the guitars, or at least my view of it, is guitars are fun. They're meant to be fun. They're not meant to be investments. They're not meant to be status symbols. They're meant to be fun. They are here to create music and give us enjoyment. So therefore, the price of those tools really doesn't matter. And what those tools are made of really doesn't matter. What matters is what you do with it. There are artists who paint with brushes. There are artists who paint with their fingers. There are artists who paint with scalpels and spatulas. And ultimately, it doesn't matter. What matters is the art that's created. What we're going to do in this episode is we are going to basically tear one of these down. I'm probably going to tear this one down. Just because. And we're going to take it apart and we're going to look and see what is the magic? What is the mojo that goes on here? And see if we can quantify it, see if we can figure it out. I'm going to do a little demo using the guitars to kind of give you an idea. And then we'll wrap things up and tell you about a little project that I'm working on. So let's dig in, take one of these guys apart, and see if we can't find the mojo. So we're out in the tool shed where I will be taking this guy apart. So what I thought I'd do is I'd start taking this apart and we'll go over the individual parts after it's all taken apart. But while I'm doing the take apart, rather than do the fast forward thing that I would normally do, I may still do that, but we'll see. I figure I'd do a voiceover of the history of Danelectro. So you get to see that and hear the history, and let's go from there. So let's start taking this guy apart.
So the Danelectro company was started back in 1947 by Nathan Daniel, and it was based out of Neptune, New Jersey. He actually started off making amps for Sears and Montgomery Ward. Sears sold them as Silvertone, and Montgomery Ward sold them as Airline. And basically, he started off making amps. He used to work for Epiphone. He worked, I think, Epiphone for a year or two, and then decided to go out on his own and start his own company. Around 1954, Sears had approached him and asked him if he could make some guitars, some affordable guitars for them to sell. So, of course, being the entrepreneur that he was, he said sure and started making guitars. The thing is that he was more of an electrical guy, obviously starting up an amplifier company. So the luthier part of it was something he had to learn. But really, I think this is one of those instances where, I guess, ignorance truly was bliss. Because if he was a trained luthier, we never would have gotten Danelectro guitars. It never would have happened. Because no luthier would say, hey, I'm going to take these materials and make a guitar. So it's the fact that he wasn't a master luthier that got us these great guitars. And I don't know if you noticed, the neck has no truss rod. Nathan Daniel actually called truss rods a temporary fix. He installed two steel rods down the length of the neck underneath the fretboard. The idea was, it's like actually bars, two steel bars. Because by his way of thinking, that A, truss rods are expensive compared to steel rods. Two, they don't prevent the neck from warping. They just give you adjustability if it does warp. Well, how about we put something in that just prevents it from warping in the first place? Another point down that same line of thinking is the aluminum nut. You put it on once, it never wears out. You know, it's a testament to the thought process of building these things to last. Sure, they were inexpensive guitars, but they built them to last. And there's guitars still out there from the 50s that whose necks are as straight as they were when they came out of the factory. The list of innovations that came out of that factory in Neptune, New Jersey are really impressive. They were one of the first companies, along with Fender, to produce an electric bass. In fact, D'Addario, the string company, credits Nathan Daniel for pioneering the use of round wound strings on basses. Some of the first double neck guitars. He was the first one to introduce a six string bass back in the 60s. He was one of the first companies to introduce a baritone guitar. All of these innovations, just one right after another, all from this factory in New Jersey. I was reading this one article where it was talking about the Mount Rushmore of guitar designers. And sure, you're going to put Leo Fender up there. You're probably going to put Ted McCarty up there. But you're probably also going to have to put Nathan Daniel up there. Now, what happened to Danelectro, the company, was towards the mid-60s, I think it was. Let me see here. Yeah, late 60s. He was torn between either expanding the business or basically selling out. And what he ended up doing was selling to MCA. Now, through all this, from the 40s all the way to the late 60s, Sears had been turned over from different owners numerous times. But with every change in the company at Sears, he managed to maintain his relationships there. And that was his big customer. MCA bought Danelectro in the late 60s. And if you know anything about MCA, pretty much everything they touch turns to crap. And before long, they lost the Sears account because, you know, MCA. And as soon as that happened, Danelectro lost its main source of revenue and it quickly declined and went out of business. So back in the 1990s, there was a comeback. So there was a guy by the name of, or is a guy by the name of Steve, I think he pronounced the name Rittinger. So his notion was he wanted to acquire an iconic brand to produce guitar pedals. He wasn't interested in producing guitars at all. Much the same way as Nathan Daniel wasn't really all that interested in producing guitars at first. He acquired the brand and started producing pedals. So they got the pedals out into the market. And they were really good. Anybody who knows Danelectro pedals from, you know, the first ones that came out and even the ones that are out now, all very good, good designs. I have a Danelectro Daddy-O pedal, which is an overdrive pedal, which is phenomenal. They've released these pedals and all of the music stores said, hey, these are great. Where are the guitars? And he was just like, huh? So just basically from the demand from his customers saying, yeah, man, start reproducing the guitars. So the first thing they did was reissue the U2, the 1956 reissue. And those things sold like crazy. I think he said in his first year, they sold 100,000 guitars, which is unreal to sell 100,000 guitars in a year. So, and I bought four of them. So four of those 100,000 were mine. So since the reintroduction, the company has gone up and down. They are producing all sorts of different guitars, even to this day. The original reissues were made in Korea. Then they moved manufacturing to China. And they have recently, very wisely, decided to move manufacturing back to Korea. So Korean guitar manufacturers are fantastic. That's a good thing for us guitar lovers. They are producing reissues like inspired by the original guitars. They're also producing more updated versions of the originals with more updated modern hardware. They've also recently started doing some Mosrite inspired guitars. So they are expanding their guitar business. And thankfully, again, the manufacturing is back in Korea. So hopefully we'll start seeing some even better guitars further down the road. So that kind of brings us up to date for the history. Amazing guitar company. Check it out. There's tons of information online about all the different stuff. I just kind of glossed over a lot of details. But if you really want to dig in and do some interesting reading, check it out.
All right. So now that we have the guitar broken down into its requisite bits, let's see if we can't take a look at the anatomy of this thing. So as you can see inside, the support is essentially plywood. So it is just a plywood ring that goes around the entire guitar. And then there's plywood here. I don't think it goes all the way through. I don't think it's a block, but we can look. I don't think it is. And we can see what makes her tick. And the top and bottom is just that press board, Masonite. That's all it is. Now it's painted, so it's kind of hard to see that it's Masonite. But if you look in there, you can see the brown of the Masonite right there. It's the same material that the pickguard's made out of. So the pickguard's made out of that same material. It just has a white covering on it here. I don't know if that's paint or there's a process, I think it's called melanine. I'll find out the correct name for it and put it up here. But it is essentially just a press board with a white covering. And that's all they use. It's the same press board that's used for the body. Now let's just look inside the pickup cavities for a second. Okay, so we got a plywood block that is for the bridge supports, which is just two wood screws. And we'll look at the bridge here in a second. So just two wood screws that support the bridge into that plywood. Then another block of plywood that is below the pickup, a little piece of foam here for some cushion. And it looks like, yeah, so it looks like that. It's a small block that runs, so it's a big block here, big block of plywood, well, big, probably about, 3 inches by 2 inches. And then a smaller piece of plywood that runs the length here, that's probably about, I would say, maybe an inch and a quarter wide, that supports the, that's there for, well, obviously, structural support here, but also for the pickups. For the pickups to sit on, and they have a little cushion there. And as you can see, the way the pickups attach is through these legs and screws that come through the bottom. And then as we go further back to the neck pocket, obviously you can see the plywood again. So just the plywood structure. This is also plywood. So this, as you can see, there's some bubbling here, like where it's separating from the body, the vinyl tape, the binding tape, as they call it. And that's fairly common for this to happen. It's really not that big of a deal.
And that's the only place where the tape is really coming up is over here and over here, which is fairly common. And so let's take a deeper dive on the pickups. So these are the famed lipstick pickups. There are plenty of YouTube videos that go into what's inside one of these pickups. And I like my pickups and I'm not going to tear one apart. So forget that. But essentially all it is a piece of magnet. I think it's an Alnico 2. I could be wrong about that. It could be ceramic. But it's basically a bar magnet that they put some Kapton tape around. So Kapton tape is kind of a yellowish insulating tape that's used in electronics. And they wind the wire, the copper wire, around, physically right around the magnet. So that's why they have to put the Kapton tape on the magnet to, you know, so it doesn't, so the copper wire doesn't short out against the magnet. And then they basically tape all that up. And coming out of the holes here, you have the two, you have the hot wire and the negative wire. And this is a ground, so this is basically just a shielded cable. And this connection here is ground. So ground, positive and negative. And that goes to our potentiometers and switches and such. Someone has decided to join us. May I help you? You want to say hey? No? Okay. Have a good day. All right, guys. This is my third time trying to explain this. It's a very weird thing. So most guitars are wired in parallel, and this one is wired in series.
1, 2, 3.
So it's a very, very weird way of doing wiring. When I started looking this stuff up, I was like, what? They did what? So it really is very unique. This right here, along with this right here, these guys, this is what makes the sound, obviously, right? This is what makes Danelectros unique. This is what gives them their chime. This is what gives them their sparkle. This is what makes a Danelectro a Danelectro. So I think what happened is when they made the lipstick pickups and they said, okay, here's what we got. Now we need to build or design a wiring scheme that accommodates the pickups that we were able to make for the price we were able to make them for. Because this doesn't cost a whole lot of money in comparison. Yeah, these potentiometers are a little bit more expensive, but in the grand scheme of things, it's just wire and which way the wire goes and capacitors and that, all that you were going to spend anyway. So the way this was wired, the when they came up with the wiring scheme on this guy, is really what makes this thing sound the way it sounds. Alrighty, so here is the Danelectro bridge. It is essentially a metal plate with a piece of rosewood attached to it with this screw. So to adjust your intonation, you can loosen the screw, move your rosewood back and forth, tilt it this way or that way, and that's how you adjust your intonation. Now, that right there is about the cheapest way you could possibly make a bridge. This thing here, I believe, is also greatly responsible for the Danelectro tone. Later versions or more modern versions of the Danelectros have what could be considered more standard bridge with individual adjustable saddles made of metal. And I've played them, and they sound fine. There's nothing, I know people who love those guitars. But to me, and this may just be a me thing, I think these ones with the rosewood bridge sound better than the ones with the metal bridge. I think the Rosewood Bridge kind of mellows out the tone, where the metal bridges on some of the more recent Danelectros, I think they sound, you know, they sound a little harsh. They sound a little almost too high-endy. I really do think these Rosewood bridges, as simple as they are, have an effect on the tone as well. I think this helps out quite a bit, along with the electronics. These two wood screws that go into plywood, the two circles kind of sit in there, so but now you still have the ability to adjust the bridge this way, right? And then you have the other screw that holds the bridge in, which again is just a wood screw. You tighten this down and you leave it a little bit loose so this can come up a little bit. And then that's how you adjust it. That's the bridge. Three wood screws, a piece, basically a piece of steel, and a piece of rosewood. And that's your intonation point. Yeah, we're gonna clean this up some. We're gonna do some work on these frets. Yeah, we're gonna do a little work to this before we get it all together. This has been well played and well loved. Much nicer.
Nice.
Magic eraser for little things like that. They work great. So as we can see, we definitely have some dirt and grime and, you know, just what you would expect over, what now, 30 years of use. Not that uncommon. Hopefully you can see that difference there before and after.
Shing! Sparkle, sparkle.
So we've done these three, and we're still doing these here. So big, big difference. One other aspect that I forgot to point out that leads to the way Danelectro sound. Aluminum nut. So the nut is made of basically an aluminum bar. It's a stock, like, eighth-inch piece of aluminum bar attached with a screw to the neck and then notched out for a nut. That's it. All right, there she is, all back together and ready to be strung up. So as we can see, there's really not much to these things. If you said, hey Keith, I need you to build a guitar for me by Friday, this is probably how I would do it. So I kind of admire, like, the ingenuity of the manufacturing process. So this guitar was owned by a buddy of mine by the name of Matt Story, who I'm sure you guys have heard me mention a number of different times. He is one of my cohorts in geardom. I had Danelectros back in the day and stupidly sold them and had missed them ever since. And I was going to a guitar shop in Nashville to get some work done on a couple of different guitars. And while I was walking around his shop, I saw that other Danelectro, that dark purple, what's called a U1. And I had a U2 and a U1 back in the day. And I picked it up and I played it. And I was just like, oh my God. As I was buying it, I texted my friend Matt and said, hey, I just bought this. And I said, I'm dropped off two and I'm leaving with one. And he's like, man, I have that that two pickup Dano, that the 59. If you want that, I'll sell it to you. I'm just like, okay. So I went from having no Danelectros to two in a matter of 15 minutes. So I'm glad to have these back in my life. And let's go play them.
Thank you.
Well, that should wrap up our adventure into Danelectro land. Figured I'd show you this one at the end, just because the other one was getting so much love during the episode. It's really dark purple. I think they called it plum. Great, great guitars. Some of my favorite guitars that I've ever owned were Danelectros. Very simple guitars, very easy to play, and they produce great tone. And in the demo, I just did clean tones, but these things dirty up pretty nicely as well. Maybe I'll show you that in the future, because as I announced at the beginning of the video, I was going to talk about a little project I'm working on. So as I was delving into these guys, I was saying, you know, I probably could build one of these. So I'm going to attempt to build my own Danelectro inspired guitar. I'm not quite a neck builder, so I bought a Danelectro neck, or at least a copy or replacement of a Danelectro neck. I think the one I bought has a truss rod, but we'll see. We'll see if I like it or not. If not, I'll try to find another one. But I'm going to build a replica of what was called a Dano Pro. And I'll put a picture up. The Dano Pro was a model that I really liked. And when they came out, I thought about buying one, and I didn't. And I was really dumb, because they are worth so much money right now. It's ridiculous. I think when they came out, they were like $300. And now you go to buy them, they're $600, $700, and $800. Sourcing parts, it may take a little while, but that's what I'm going to be doing. I'm going to build my own Dano. But that should wrap it up. Questions, comments, concerns, cries of outrage, hit me up in the comments below, and we'll catch you guys later.